President Duterte still won't allow the resumption of face-to-face classes despite the arrival of Chinese-made COVID-19 vaccines in the country. Duterte made that remark shortly after the vaccines arrived at the Villamor Air Base in Pasay City last Sunday. Duterte said he did not want to risk losing the lives of young Filipinos by easing health measures in educational institutions. But some senators and some groups argue schools should partially reopen soon as distance learning has become challenging for both students and teachers. Joining us now for more on this, we have Education Undersecretary Diosdado San Antonio. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Good morning, Christian. Good morning to our viewers and listeners.
Okay, we know that you were supposed to conduct a pilot test for limited face-to-face classes last January, but that had to be shelved because of a decision by President Rodrigo Duterte. Now, he again announced last night that the limited face-to-face classes would still have to wait. But based on the data in the possession of the Department of Education, should that be the policy, or perhaps some areas, not necessarily those that are encountering a surge in cases, that those other areas are in fact ready for limited face-to-face classes as we speak?
Christian, the Department of Education belongs to the executive branch of the government, and our president is the one who makes the final decisions. Secretary Leonor Liling Magdolis Briones has informed us that the Department of Education will continue to do the preparations even as we await the final approval of the holding of limited face-to-face. So we will implement the decision, but we will continue to make preparations so that the moment we are allowed to do this, we would be able to do it immediately.
Okay, so what kind of preparations are you doing now?
We're, of course, the identification of the schools located in areas where the risks are very low is continuing. We're also making sure that the health protocols would be available in our schools. We understand that learners should have masks, face shields, hand sanitizing materials. This should be also very clear. We also have reminded our field officials, the principals, and the superintendents to collaborate closely with local government units, because we feel that any attempt to do this has to be an effort not only of the schools but also of the, it should be a collaboration among principals, local government unit leaders, mayors, governors, and the parents. So we have been emphasizing this as a way to really prepare ourselves for the eventual holding of initially limited face-to-face and eventually adoption of the new normal in the basic education sector.
Okay, now based on the current preparations being done by the DepEd, for example, can you give us an idea of which particular areas might be suitable for such limited face-to-face classes?
I don't have the list with me, but my understanding was initially in very populous areas, the urban centers, it's very unlikely that we would be able to do this in schools located in urban centers. So essentially, we're looking at schools that are relatively isolated, that have been consistent, that whose like areas, barangay or town, have been relatively having very low COVID cases, if not zero cases.
Okay. Now, for the DepEd, what's your new target? I mean, just thinking of the current data that you have, for instance, do you have any target, for instance, as to when the limited face-to-face classes might be conducted?
What we're trying to do now is look at the possibility of requesting exemption for certain groups of learners, which we feel should be given the opportunity to learn while in school, like our TVL learners in the senior high school. They need exposure to our equipment, and so we are preparing the documentation so that we can make a an attempt to request for an exemption for this kind of learners.
Okay. Now, when you talk about limited face-to-face classes, how big would the class be, for instance? Let's say a class that can accommodate 40 students or pupils.
Normally, our classrooms can't accommodate more than 20 learners, 15 to 20 learners in a class. So there would be staggered attendance in school, and coming in and going out of the school would also have to be staggered. We know that even the president is aware that it's manageable while the kids are in school. So the bigger concern is the coming in and going out of the children from the school to their residences. So that's why we really feel that the local governments and even our transportation facilities should be properly addressed and coordinated in areas where the kids have to commute in order for them to go
okay.
to school.
But how will it go? For instance, you have a class of, let's say, 40 students or pupils. Let's say 20 of them are willing to go to school for the limited face-to-face classes. What will happen to the rest? Or can they also be accommodated by batch? Meaning certain students would like to go to the actual classroom during specific days of the week or the month, while the others might substitute. Ganun ba yung sistema ang iniisip natin dito?
Christian, first, we'll make it very clear that in case this is allowed, we will not force children whose parents would not feel at ease sending their children to school. So it would still be voluntary. And then, as you mentioned, while a few, like the first group, if there are two groups that will be in a class, the first group is in school, the other group would continue to do home-based learning. It's also possible that there would be three groups. It depends on the class size. But what I said was a maximum of 20 in our average classrooms. And 15 in smaller classrooms.
Okay.
And also, so we will not impose a one-size-fits-all approach in doing this. We'll just say that these are the maximum numbers of children you can have, so the principals can decide whether to do a once-a-week reporting to school or twice-a-week or thrice-a-week, depending on the arrangements they make with the parents and the local government officials.
Okay, now any template or perhaps best practices that you can use coming from abroad, meaning those countries that have already begun limited face-to-face classes, which we can use here in the Philippines? Any lessons?
We have been, of course, monitoring what's happening around the world, and we know that in some countries, they do staggered reporting of learners to school. Some come as early as 7, and then another group would go after an hour, etc. So that will really minimize the opportunity for the learners to be gathering in at one time in our gates. The other thing that we see would be really just like everywhere, the use, the wearing of masks, the wearing of face shields, and hand sanitizing facilities that are also made available in the schools. Some schools that can afford may perhaps do providing some kind of barriers between seats while the learners are inside the school.
Okay. Now, I'm not sure whether you've heard this comment, but I've heard this from a number of people. Those who are actually open to the idea of limited face-to-face classes in areas with no big number of cases of COVID-19, one of their concerns is that, why are we very particular about refusing not to conduct limited face-to-face classes, when in fact, if you look around, there are so many people out in the streets, protocols are not exactly being followed in certain areas, and then restaurants are even more open than schools. Why are we doing this to schools? I mean, how do you address concerns like that?
As I've said, we will be implementing decisions of our authorities, and that's the training we have in the Department of Education. So we will just implement what has been decided on, and the Secretary of Education is always ready to make presentations and explanations at the right fora. So that's how we will be handling this concern.
Okay. Now let's talk about assessment. How do you intend to assess, or any assessment instruments that will be used at the end of this educational learning arrangements during the pandemic? Because one concern is that we know that we have to really try to do this despite the pandemic, but the problem is that this might also go to waste because of certain attitudes or certain problems that were not exactly addressed. The concern that students might be actually missing out on certain crucial lessons or learnings despite this effort to actually come up with the educational measure system or mechanism during the pandemic.
Of course, for now, we will be considering the grades of the learners. So we are gathering data. It's not yet complete, but the general picture submitted to us by the regional directors indicate that a significant number of learners have obtained passing marks during the first quarter. We hope to be able to do like bigger assessments as well. But other than that, we're also undertaking a research project that would allow us to understand how the schools have responded to the challenges they have identified, and at the same time, for us to also be able to recognize our fellow teachers and schools that have been able to initiate innovative interventions that address concerns you have raised. I have just been to a school. I had a short chat with a principal, and I asked her about the challenges and about the idea that there may be learners who may be dropping out or who may not be interested. But she assured me that in most of the cases, when the teachers are able to speak with the parents and the learners resume being engaged in the learning task. So there's an ongoing monitoring while we, of course, the only way we can say that the learners have passed using our grading system is the grades. But other than that, we really take note of what's happening, and we always encourage our field officials even to do the interventions. They know what's going to be done, and they are doing it on the basis of what I had gathered in my visit just like 30 minutes ago to a school somewhere here in Cavite.
Do they have any adjustments in terms of a strategy, let's say after this pandemic is over, once classes, face-to-face classes actually resume? Any adjustments or strategies as to somehow make up for lost time, so to speak, during the pandemic in terms of education or learning?
Of course, we're targeting at making sure that the kids should have learned at least the foundational skills that they need for lifelong learning. So what we imagine the moment we're allowed to do even the limited face-to-face is to really be more focused on our assessments, the formative and summative assessments, to validate and verify whether the kids have like learning gaps which should be bridged, and perhaps strengths as well, so that we can further provide them with enrichment, those learners. But I know that there are also learners who have been able to demonstrate that they are capable of learning even using the remote.
Will that also entail adjusting the curriculum, for instance, to accommodate certain subjects that were not made available during the pandemic? Hello, sir. Undersecretary San Antonio. Okay, I think we lost
making
him.
Making sure that Filipinos are able to continue to learn. So yes, we'll make sure that the diagnosis of what they've learned, how deep the learning was, would be identified immediately when the new normal comes.
Okay, I need to hear that again, because we're talking of something very important here. We lost you a bit there, sir. If I may just repeat the question, I was asking about certain adjustments that might be on the table. For instance, once we resume classes face to face after the pandemic, I mean, are we also looking at, let's say, adjusting the curriculum to be able to, let's say, accommodate subjects that were not made available during the pandemic, things like that?
We will be very flexible, and the review of the curriculum is ongoing. We're in Actually, I'm in a attending a workshop today, reviewing. Coming up with a strategy and how we would be able to design the hope for refinements in the curriculum. So we'll make sure that those concerns you raised would be addressed as we transition to the so-called new normal in basic education. The other thing that I see is even after we have declared success over COVID-19, the mode of delivering basic education services perhaps would no longer be that reliant on the traditional face-to-face that we had before, because we know now that there are learners more engaged in the lessons if they are allowed more flexibility. So what we hope to see is really flexibility in the manner we are able to do things, and at the same time more respect for our teachers and school principals in terms of the appropriate interventions they can initiate to address the need for making all learners really learn those that are expected to be learned by them during the year or during the cycle where the kids are in.
Yeah, and of course, people should realize that we're talking here of basic education, that if they don't get or fully understand or grasp the basics of education, so to speak, I mean, this could lead to further problems down the line. And of course, we're all doing what we can despite the pandemic. So that's why I keep asking about certain modes of assessment and what kind of other adjustments that you are willing to take, let's say, if this thing drags on, which is my final point, sir. What other adjustments are you seeing in case the pandemic drags on much further?
If that worst scenario happens, what we'll do is continue to somehow come up with innovations and interventions that will address the challenges we are seeing now. So what I mean is, in case there's a prolonged closure of schools, we will really find ways of improving the multiple distance learning delivery modalities that we offer now. We're glad that the local governments, many of them, are investing on learning gadgets that are powered by technology, and we feel that this is something that's very useful, because this will minimize our reliance on paper-based learning resources, which of course is harmful to the environment and at the same time very costly. Yes, we will harvest the lessons we are learning from implementing the distance learning delivery modalities that we have now. So I see more efforts from us, and including our fellow teachers and principals, in terms of refining the things that we have done now. Because I know that even prior to the opening of the school year, we really were saying that we are not promising a perfect system. So this is a system that is dynamic, that continues to be monitored, and we continue to provide enhancements and appropriate adjustments in the things that we do, so that in the end, the kids would really be able to get the chance of learning. Okay. We're also actually mindful of the disadvantaged sector. So I've been also proposing during meetings that we have to be more attentive to the needs of our disadvantaged learners, because of course learners from the advantaged groups would not need as much support as those coming from disadvantaged backgrounds.
Okay. Education Undersecretary Diosdado San Antonio, thank you for joining us, sir.
Thank you.